We started the quasi-free electron model, and as a first step, I talked about our introduce to the free electrons in a ghost lattice. First step, which is essentially the zero order approximation, and where we consider a crystal, and we are thinking about simple metals. So we are considering a crystal with a given Bravais lattice, and as a zero order approximation, we took a constant for the potential, for the crystal potential. So this is the average. Crystal potential, the average of the crystal potential, the constant, and we imposed that this average value is zero. It doesn't lose any generality in the sense we just shift the energy spectrum in by taking this, we just measure the energy spectrum with respect to the average value of the crystal potential. So this potential, this constant potential is also periodic, has the periodicity of the Bravais lattice, and therefore we can use Bloch's theorem. And we can write the eigenstate as exponential I k r times u of r with k belonging to the Brillouin zone of our crystal Bravais lattice and u having the periodicity of our crystal Bravais lattice, which is a ghost lattice in the sense we approximate the potential as a constant, but we still have in mind the ghost of the lattice. So U is periodic with the periodicity of the ghost Bravais lattice. So this was this is our zero order approximation, and we will see what will be the results, because then we can plot the band structure inside the Brillouin zone. And we will discuss the form of the eigenstate. But before doing that, I have a parenthesis where I want to discuss the normalization of the function u. So for the periodic functions, this u function they have the periodicity of the Bravais lattice because of Bloch's theorem. So u of r plus capital R, with capital R belonging to the Bravais lattice of my crystal, is equal to u of R for any R belonging to the Bravais lattice. So the normalization one introduced in solid state physics for this periodic part, the u of the Laplace function is that when one integrates over the unit cell, so omega means that here I'm integrating over the unit cell of the function u of r modulus square. So this integration over r cube is equal to 1. So this is the way we normalize this periodic function in solid state physics. And because this function u of r have the periodicity of the Bravais lattice, I can write them as a Fourier series. They are periodic, and therefore I can always write them as a Fourier series. So my u of r, I can always write them as a sum over the reciprocal lattice vector of my Bravais lattice, sum over g belonging to the reciprocal lattice of my crystal Bravais lattice, and a coefficient u tilde of g exponential I g r. So my u are periodic, and I can always write them as a Fourier series. Okay? Like in one dimension, if I have a periodic function, I can always write them with cos and sines of 2 pi over a. So this is in three dimensions. My u of r can be written this way. And I can actually calculate these coefficients u of g from my u. So for a vector g belonging to the reciprocal lattice, if I integrate over the unit cell u of r exponential minus e I j r, r cube, I'm obtaining, using the Fourier series here for u, sum over g prime from the reciprocal lattice, u tilde of g prime, integration over the unit cell of exponential I j coming from here, minus j prime coming from here, r, the r cube. Okay? Yes?
Yes,
okay. And this has the properties that it is non-zero only when g is equal to g prime. This is because this exponential, this part of the Fourier, on what we expand in the Fourier series, have as average value zero in the unit cell, except for the g equal zero component. So when one has this exponential, the only case when this integration is non-zero is when this part is equal to zero. For all other vectors of the reciprocal lattice, the average of this periodic function when one takes it over one unit cell is zero. It's like the sine and cosine. if you integrate it of two, n to pi over a, if you integrate it over a, a periodic, I mean, a unit cell, then you get zero. The average is zero, except for cosine of zero, which will give a. So here, this quantity, this integration will be the volume of the unit cell times delta j, j prime. That is, it is non-zero only when j is equal to j prime. So this integration then simplifies to all this integration there. Simplifies to u of j times the volume of the unit cell. So from there, one can have the Fourier coefficient. This means that the Fourier coefficient u of j is just equal to 1 over the volume of the unit cell times the integration over the unit cell of my function u of r exponential minus I j times r dr cube. Just from there. Okay, so we can get the Fourier coefficient of the series, the Fourier series here, just from this integration. All right, so now I'm closing my parenthesis. You know a bit more about this U and their normalization. So now I'm going back to the problem in the Gauss lattice. So I'm looking for solutions of the Hamiltonian H of k. I can apply Bloch's theorem. I can talk also about the H of k that we had seen on the general properties of the solution in a crystal. We can always write this H of k for a given periodic crystal potential, and in our specific case, the potential will be V equal to zero, but we can always use this H of k, uk of r, this is the equation we had, is equal to epsilon k uk of r. So, and we will apply it for a free electron in the Gauss lattice using as potential a constant, and this constant is equal to zero. So we use our equation for a given k in the Brillouin zone, and we want to solve this in the free electron case in the Gauss lattice. So the h of k in this case with v equal to zero is equal to minus h bar square over 2m the gradient plus I k square. So this is in the case v equal to zero or h of k, and I have the k inside the Brillouin zone of my ghost lattice, my crystal lattice. So this is the equation we have to solve. Now, of course, we know that the solution have to be plane waves, because the psi k, the Bloch state has to be a plane wave in the sense that we are solving for the free electron case, so the solution have to be plane waves. Even because what we are doing here is just to rewrite the solution with a uk times exponential ikr, but the solution have to remain free electron solution, so they have to be plane waves, and they have to be periodic, because by definition or by of the Bloch state have to be periodic. So the solution, this solution UK, I can already say that they have to have two properties. One is that they have to be plane waves. So the full solution of the Bloch state is exponential IKR, which is a plane wave, multiplied by uk of r, which has also to be a plane wave to have as a product a plane wave. So my uk of r have to be plane waves because the Bloch state in this case are solution of the free electron problem, have to be free electron state. So my uk of r have to be plane waves, and in addition they have to be periodic, with the periodicity of the Bravais lattice, because this is what we had from Bloch's theorem. So we know that UK have to have these two properties, and we also know from the definition of the reciprocal lattice that the only plane waves that have the full periodicity of the Bravais lattice are objects that are like EIJR with J belonging to the reciprocal lattice. So we have seen that the only plane waves that have the full periodicity of the Bravais lattice are these plane waves with J belonging to the reciprocal lattice. And now, from what I had shown you before, since we want our UK to be normalized over the unit cell omega, with volume omega, then I can put here a normalization factor 1 over the square root of omega, because I want that when I integrate this over the unit cell, I'm obtaining 1. So I put this 1 over the square root of omega. So these are the solutions of this equation. Well, okay, I know that they have to have this property, and therefore these are the states that have these two properties. Now, that they are eigenstate of that is, rather clear, that is, if I'm applying this to this UK of R, sorry, this is a J. So if I'm applying my Hamiltonian H of K on this state, I'm obtaining H bar square over 2m J plus k square exponential I j r. So my Hamiltonian hk was this. So when I apply this on the plane wave, I'm obtaining here an I j. And then when I do it twice, I'm obtaining this as eigenvalue, and I'm re-obtaining the exponential, of course. Okay? So these have the right form and are eigenstate of my H of K. Everybody agrees? All okay so far? No?
In this case, must we solve the equation using that form of log K?
This we have seen in the course before. You agree with that?
I'm saying that mostly solve this equation using that form, the form of U of T.
Yes.
Mostly solve this equation using that form.
I didn't understand. Most?
Mostly solve the equation for the H U K equals using the form of U of K equals to 1 or root of omega epsilon star.
Yes. So this, I mean, here I wrote in the most general, I mean, these are all the states that have these two properties. You agree with that? Because they are plane waves, and the only plane waves that have the periodicity of the Bradley lattice are these objects, this exponential ijr with j belonging to the reciprocal lattice. So I know that my uk of r have to have this this form because of these two properties. And then when I apply my h of k, I can see that as eigenvalue I'm obtaining this. They are eigenstate because this the exponential eigenstate of the gradient. I mean, when one derives, one obtains the exponential. So they have they are also eigenstate. Okay. All right. So these are my eigenvalues. My epsilon k here. So they have, these are the states basically. They have the right properties for the periodicity, and they give eigenvalue of h of k, they give this g plus k square over the proportional to g plus k square. Okay, so this is what we have, and now I'm going to open it here. So now we are going to plot this in the one-dimensional case. So let's now consider this in one dimension. I want to plot now my bands in the Brillouin zone in this context. So in the free electron, for the free electron in a ghost lattice. So as a function of k, I'm plotting my energies. So I know that I can focus just on the spectrum inside the Brillouin zone, so going from pi over a and minus pi over a. And so in one dimension I have a lattice parameter a, and my g vectors are n times 2 pi over a with n integral, for any n integral. And now my energies epsilon of k from there are h bar square over 2m k plus m times 2 pi over a square. So this is in one dimension what I have there for the eigenvalues. So I can start plotting this for different n. So I will consider first n equal to 0. I'm obtaining just h bar square, k square over 2m. So for n, it's a parabola that will be centered at the origin. Oops. So this is the case n equal to 0. And at the edge here, I will obtain for k equal to pi over a, I will just obtain h bar square over 2m pi over a square. So this is the value here at this point. And this is the band that I'm obtaining with n equal to 0. Okay? Now, for the next one, n equal to minus 1. If I put minus 1 here, I'm obtaining k minus 2 pi over a square. So it's a parabola that will be centered at minus 2 pi over a. So this is minus, so we have, I will extend this. So for n equal to minus 1, I will have here 2 pi over a outside the green zone. And if I put minus 1, my parabola will be centered at 2 pi over a. So I will have a parabola that will go like this. This is outside the Brillouin zone, so I'm not taking it into account. But the parabola will go like this if I put here minus 1. It's centered at 2 pi over a, and it will, for the value k equal to pi, I will obtain here pi over a square, so it goes through this point, and at 0, I will obtain 2 pi over a square, so this value here is equal to h bar square over 2m, times 2 pi over a square. Okay? So this is for n equal to minus 1, this band here. And when I take n is equal to plus 1, then here I will obtain k plus 2 pi over a. So it's a parabola that is centered at minus 2 pi over a. So just this one. So this is n equal 1. So this is what we obtain for the lowest n. Then if we continue, we will obtain for other n bands higher in energy. But as you can see, it's essentially the free electron spectrum that is folded inside the Brillouin zone by translating the part outside by G vectors. So if you want, the free electron band would go like this and like this. This would be the free electron without any period and without any ghost lattice. Now, if I introduce my ghost lattice, this branch that is outside the Brillouin zone, I can shift it inside the Brillouin zone by a G vector, minus 2 pi over A, and I obtain the same spectrum because, of course, the energy spectrum, one cannot change it. It has to remain that of the free electron. It's just a different representation. One has the full spectrum inside the Brillouin zone from Bloch's theorem. So basically, this part in my representation, I have it here. And this part of the spectrum, I have it here. I'm just changing the representation. In other words, I'm rewriting my plane wave of the free electron. So I know that my solution are free of the initial Hamiltonian, and the crystal Hamiltonian, my Bloch states are exponential I kx exponential I and 2 pi over a x. These are the Bloch states. They are plane waves, the free electron plane waves. So my free electron plane waves, I have just rewritten them this way with the vector g equal to a vector inside the Brillouin zone plus a g vector, a reciprocal lattice vector. So what I did is just rewriting my free electron state as a Bloch state with the exponential I kx with k inside the Brillouin zone times a periodic function which is the exponential I n 2 pi over x. So I have just rewritten things in a Bloch representation, but the states are the same. In the end, the free electron state of the crystal Hamiltonian remain plane waves, the original eigenstate. Okay, is it clear? Any question? Yes?
In the previous case, you just wrapped it. We had a Schrodinger equation, hk uk r equals to ek uk r, like for the block u, block
yes.
state u, periodic state u. So we proposed a certain solution, uk r equals 1 by root omega e to the power I z dot r.
Yeah, this.
Yes, ma'am.
This is the u without the normalization. Yeah.
And then we got, we realized that the eigenvalues for this u state is h squared by 2m g plus k. But the eigenvalue is, eigenvalues are continuous in k, but eigen function does not have that continuity in k. For example, it has got a g vector which is a discrete, which just takes discrete values n into 2 pi by a. In general, if we include this factor e to the power iks, kx, then there will be a continuity in eigen functions. But if we just take because we, when we got the solution, we didn't, like, it could have been just a problem in math that we could have just taken u vector. But
if you want, you still have the continuity, but it's folded. So, I mean...
Yes, ma'am. That is the continuity in eigenvalues. But the eigen functions does not have that continuity. It's just e to the power I z dot r.
Well, I mean...
And g takes discrete values.
Yes, but if you want, you have a g vector that progressively increases if you want, so it's inside the, let's say, I'm talking about this one. Okay, in reciprocal space, you can increase it, so first it's inside the Brillouin zone, and then you touch the Brillouin zone, you go outside, and you just fold it, then inside, I mean, you go from a Wigner side cell in reciprocal state of a lattice point to the next one, and you just fold it inside the initial one. But you don't lose that. It's just a modulo the Brillouin zone, next Brillouin zone of the Brillouin zone if you want. So in space you have the first Brillouin zone, you have some other similar zone associated to another point in the reciprocal lattice, and when you start entering the other one, you can always bring it back by translation and invariance inside the first Brillouin zone. So that's just what you do, but you don't lose anything.
But that is in the small g. The continuity is in small g because it also includes a continuous vector k.
This one, yes.
But while we
yes,
ma'am. But while we started today, we didn't worry about psi. Psi as eigenfunction, we like started our problem as u as eigenfunction, hu
yeah.
equals to eu.
Mm-hmm.
So while we proposed a solution for u, we proposed a discrete solution, e to the power I z dot r. Like it is continuous in a real space, but in reciprocal space it has got a
in vector. K.
Yes, ma'am. K space
but in
g.
K, what we were saying, the only thing we were saying from the when we were discussing the h of k, is that for each k we have a discrete spectrum, and that we have continuity in the band, which we have. We have bands which are continuous in k, and we have for each k a discrete spectrum.
But the u. We like we wrote our solution something like uk equals to 1 by under root omega e to the power I z dot r.
You mean this?
Yes, ma'am, this.
Yes.
So we wrote it as uk r. But can we write it as uk r because the k index is not represented in the right hand side?
Ah, okay, now I see. Yes, the this, okay. This is a special case where actually the u doesn't depend on the k. It's because it's the free electron case. But it's not forbidden in the sense, in principle, it depends on k, but you can have a function which is also a constant of k. And in this case, actually, it doesn't depend on the k, the u. But it's a very special case, and it's just because it's the free electron gas.
But it is like a slightly...
It's like an extreme case, but
because
well...
the eigenfunction is independent of k, but eigenvalues are dependent on k.
Yeah, they are all the k dependence come from the other part. And in this, for the h of k, just from the k plus gradient, just from... you are right. It's the special case where the u of k actually don't depend on k. And this is an exception. Usually it depends, but not in the free electron.
So this ek is the eigenvalue of the psi k, the whole solution. This
yes.
One. Yes. So actually, I should have like realized this a little.
Mm. No, it's it's just a different representation, and instead of having just one parabola, one has a discrete spectrum with bands.
Actually,
also in this limit.
Since we started solving for UK directly, I like just thought from that point, but we, I should have realized that actually that form of the Schrodinger equation, half of the work was already done previously when we wrote k plus.
Okay, I mean, the idea is that, of course, this is an exercise to rewrite it in the Bloch form, and it's correct technically because V, a constant, is also periodic, so one is allowed to do it. It sounds just an exercise of the mind, but actually we are preparing the zero order state to have the right form to apply perturbation theory. So this is the idea of the whole exercise here. We do this because we want to have the state already in a Bloch form so that we can then apply perturbation theory directly from the H of K. So we need the states to have already the form of U states for the zero order Hamiltonian before applying perturbation theory. So it's just symmetrizing in the correct form for the next step, the eigenstate of the free electron case, the H zero Hamiltonian, the zero order Hamiltonian. Okay. So now this is what we are going to do. That is, the next step is to introduce a weak periodic potential, and we will apply perturbation theory. So the free electron in the ghost lattice was the zero order step. Now we do the first order step. So the next step is to introduce a weak periodic potential. So, going back to my picture of the beginning of the quasi-free electron approximation, I have my potential V of R here, which would have a bare potential due to the ion. Let's say it would be like this, and then I have a weak periodic potential that is the potential taking into account also the electrons. So we draw it this way. So this is my crystal potential that is taking into account my mean field crystal potential, taking into account also the presence of other valence electrons. So I have in mind a simple method, and the Schrödinger equation for the valence electron of this simple method would be like this. So this is taking into account also the other electrons. Okay, so this is my weak potential. Of course, this one would not be weak, but taking into account the screening due to the other of the bare potential due to the electrons, then I have a midfield potential which is much weaker, and that I can use in perturbation theory. That is the idea. So, given that my potential here in red is periodic, has the periodicity of my Bravais lattice, I can also write it as a Fourier series. So, sum over the G belonging to the reciprocal lattice, a Fourier coefficient, V of tilde of G, exponential I J R. So, here I just use the fact that it has the periodicity of the crystal, of the Bravais lattice of my crystal, and I can always write it as a Fourier series, okay? So now the idea is that this potential in red is a smooth potential in the sense that its wiggle are relatively slow, doesn't have very, very fast change or changes on a very, very small scale. It doesn't have rapidly changing with R curls. It's a smooth thing. So in one dimension, if I write this Fourier series, if I go in order of increasing J, that have increasing norms, it's also valid in any dimension. If I increase the norm of G, I go in real wavelength that are shorter and shorter. Increasing G, since it's 2 pi over the wavelength, means going to shorter and shorter wavelength. So G equal to zero corresponds to a constant, and when one goes to larger and larger G, one has wiggles, and when one increases the G, one goes to wiggles that oscillate faster in the sense on a shorter scale in real space. So the idea is that this series, I will truncate it. I will include the G vector with the smallest norm, and I will neglect the high Fourier component, that is those that corresponds to, I will include those, but I will neglect those because my potential is smooth, and I believe I can describe it accurately with just rather smooth Fourier component. So this is the idea. So I'm writing this Fourier expansion, this Fourier series, including the G with the lowest, the smallest norm. So in one dimension, I have V of X is equal to V tilde of G equal to zero, the G equal to zero Fourier component, plus V tilde of the next one in increasing norm is 2 pi over A exponential I 2 pi A times X, plus the one with minus 2 pi over A, so V tilde of minus 2 pi over A exponential minus I 2 pi over A X. And in principle, I have a full series that continues, but I'm going to truncate it. So I'm including the G with the lowest norm because my potential is smooth and I focus on the functions that have the smoothest oscillation in my expansion. So if I take into account now, so I will include these two. The G equal to zero and the first non-zero G component. Since my potential V is real, the crystal potential is real, this implies here that V G, the complex conjugate, is equal to v tilde of minus g. So if I take the complex, the conjugate of this, I must obtain the same. So this implies that the complex conjugate of this coefficient is the coefficient for minus j. And therefore, this, which must be real, I can just write it as 2 times the real part of the first complement here, v tilde of 2 pi over a exponential I 2 pi over a x. This just is, this has to be real, and it is equal to 2 times the real part of that. So if I write, from there, I can always write this part as coefficient time a cosine of 2 pi over a x plus a phase. And given that my potential here is minimum at the origin, basically the phase would be zero, and here I can have my potential because it's minimum at the origin. In my picture, I can write it as minus v1 cosine of 2 pi over a x. Basically, each other cosine or sine, and given it is minimum at the origin, it would be a negative cosine that would describe my red curve here. So I can write it as minus v1 cosine of 2 pi over ax. My perturbation in this case would be this minus v1 cosine of 2 pi over ax. It's just, I can write it in terms of exponential as exponential I 2 pi over a x plus exponential minus I 2 pi over a x divided by 2. So this is the cosine, and this is my perturbation v of x. So for this potential v of x, we will use this potential v of x as the perturbation of free electron Hamiltonian. So starting from the solution of h k 0, that was the free electron in the ghost lattice, we will now perturbatively calculate the spectrum for h of k with this perturbation. So h of k is equal to minus h bar squared over 2m. In one dimension, it is the derivative with respect to x plus I k squared. So this is h for the free electron case. This is my zero order Hamiltonian. And then I have my perturbation v of x. So this is my hk. And this is my perturbation. And this is my unperturbed Hamiltonian. And I'm going to apply perturbation theory to the first order. Okay? Clear? So now we are going to apply perturbation theory to the first order. Apply perturbation theory and for potential which is expected to be weak, and we will do it to the first order. So I remind you what are the rules to calculate to the first order the energies. Oops. So, to the first order, if one has non-degenerate states, so non-degenerate states I with energy AI. So what I mean, we have non-degenerate states for the unperturbed Hamiltonians, the zero-order Hamiltonian. Then, in perturbation theory to the first order, the perturbed energy is E is equal to EI of zero, so the unperturbed value, plus the average value of the expectation value in the state I of the perturbation. So the average value of V evaluated as matrix element AVA plus a correction of order V squared. So this is what you should know from quantum mechanics for perturbation theory in the case of non-degenerate states. So it's the zero order energy plus the expectation value in the state of the unperturbed Hamiltonian of the perturbation. Now, if one has degenerate state, it's a little bit more complicated. So, if one has degenerate state, so let's say in N degenerate state, with eigenvalue is zero. So if the unperturbed Hamiltonian H0 has n degenerate eigenstates, then to the first order, the one has to calculate the matrix with the matrix element of the perturbation over this degenerate subspace. So one has to calculate the matrix element I V J, which I called V I J, over the state I and J that belong to the degenerate subspace or manifold. And then the energies of the first order in the perturbation AI prime are given by the unperturbed value E0 plus the eigenvalue I prime of the n by n matrix V I J. So this is the result to the first order in V, and then one has a correction of second order. So basically, one has to construct the matrix which has this matrix element Vij, so it's an n by n matrix because one had n degenerate eigenstate with this eigenvalue. So using this n degenerate eigenstate, one constructs this matrix with the matrix element of the perturbation, and then one diagonalizes this matrix, and the eigenvalues added to the zero-order value give the results to the first order, the energy to the first order. Okay? So this is when one has degenerate eigenvalues for the Hamiltonian, the unperturbed Hamiltonian. These are the results to the first order. So in this case, the eigenvalues, one will have n eigenvalues, of course, because one has an n by n matrix. So n goes from 1 to capital N. And in principle, it can split the degeneracy. So at the order zero, this n, the n state, has the same eigenvalue. And then when one adds the correction, which comes from the eigenvalue of this matrix of the perturbation, then in principle, one can have n eigenstates which differ. Some may be the same, but in principle, one can split the degeneracy. Okay, so this is just from quantum mechanics perturbation theory. Now let's look at our case for the HK with the perturbation here. So if I plot again my band structure, which was the free electron in the ghost lattice in one dimension, so I have K. Epsilon So I had my liaison with pi over a at minus pi over a. So I had this Venn structure with this. This was for n equal to 0. Then I had this. So this was for n equal to minus 1, and this one for n equal to 1. So these were my bands in the free electron case. Now, if I take a K point anywhere inside the Brillouin zone, but with no special symmetry, so not at the center of the Brillouin zone, let's say I take a K point here. Inside the Brillouin zone, and I apply what I have seen. So in this case, I will use the normalization that I have introduced for my state UK, that is UK it should be of X, I guess. If I integrate my UK over the unit cell, I normalize it to 1. So now let's say I'm considering this state here with this eigenvalue of epsilon of k, and I want to know what how much this state will be perturbed by my potential v of x that I have given before, the cosine. So I'm considering if I consider the state with n equal to 0, my uk is proportional to exponential I 0 to pi over a x. So it's just a constant. My uk is just 1 over the square root of a. This is the UK of this band, okay? It's a constant in addition of being independent of K. So this is for n equal to 0. Now if I take in general an n equal from 0, my UK is proportional to exponential I n to pi over a x. So in this case, with the normalization, I have my state uk is equal to exponential I n times 2 pi over a x divided by square root of a. So if I integrate the square, the norm squared of this state over the unit cell, I'm obtaining 1, and these are my UK state for the calculation, the evaluation of the expectation value of the perturbation. So now, if I evaluate the diagonal matrix element n of my perturbation, which was v1 times the cosine of 2 pi over a x n. So according to perturbation theory, this is what I have to evaluate for a non-degenerate state. Of course, all my state here for an arbitrary k inside the Brillouin zone that has no special symmetry, that is not at the origin, These states are non-degenerate, so I can use this to calculate the perturbation to the first order. Now this, well, I can rewrite it as 1 over A because of this normalization here. Integration from 0 to A, so this is the length of my unit cell, over the length of my unit cell, minus V1 times cos, because of course if I multiply this by the complex conjugate I will just obtain 1, so I obtain just the integration of the perturbation over the unit cell minus V1 cos of 2 pi over Ax dx. And what does this give?
This is the sine.
Excuse me?
It's the sine. That means the integral of.
Yeah, but when you evaluate it.
From 0 to A, yeah, it's just periodic, so it's going to be 0.
It's 0. In other words, also the average value of this cosine, the periodic that has the periodicity of my lattice in one dimension, is 0. This thing has as average value, sorry, as average value 0. So this is equal to 0. So basically, we get that if one has an arbitrary point inside the Vrian zone where there is no degeneracy, there is no first order correction. Okay? It is important. So no correction. First order for non-degenerate states. So the crystal potential to the first order doesn't introduce any variation in the band structure for a point here where there is no degeneracy. All right, so now this is when there is no degeneracy, but of course in this band structure we have some degeneracy in special places. So at the Vrian zone edge here we have a degeneracy. We have two states with the same energy, and also here we would have a degeneracy. So let's look at what happens there to the first order in the perturbation. So if one has degeneracy, so one has degeneracy at special points, at special places in the Vrian zone. Degeneracy are present at the Vrian zone edge. And for some bands, so in some cases. At the Vrian zone center. Okay, so there we have to apply the rule for the degenerate state, perturbation theory for the degenerate state. So in particular at pi over a, where I have the degeneracy 2, the states that are involved are these two states with n equal to 0, so the constant, and n equal to minus 1, so minus 2 pi over ax divided. So I will label these states as 0 and n in general, well, okay, minus 1. So I have to evaluate the matrix element of the type 0, v, 0, minus 1, v, 0, and of course the complex conjugate 0, v, minus 1, which is just the complex conjugate of minus 1, v, 0. And also 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1. So these two, we already know that it's 0. It's there. So we have only the off-diagonal terms which may give contributions. So let's look at it. So 0 v minus 1 is equal with my perturbation, cosine perturbation, minus v1 times 1 over a, this comes from the normalization, integration from 0 to a of my cosine, which is exponential I to pi over ax plus exponential minus I to pi over ax divided by 2 times, so one state is a constant, and the other state has this exponential minus I to pi over a x dx. So this comes from my state with n equal to minus 1. So if I want to integrate this I will keep. So this integration now, this times this gives me again an exponential minus I with an n non-zero to pi over ax. If I integrate this object, this times this, over the period, it will give me zero as average value. This is one of these exponential ij x or r that has the j non equal to zero and therefore has as average value zero on the periodic cell. So this will not give me any contribution, will give me zero, and the other term will give me something. So the other term will give me, when I multiply, I will get 1. So integrated over the cell, I will just obtain minus v1 over 2. So this is equal to minus v1 over 2. And its complex conjugate is the same. So my matrix of the perturbation will be 0 minus v1 over 2 minus v1 over 2 and 0. Okay for everyone? Yes. Yeah?
Please have to repeat them.
Yes.
Why the this one that the e exponent minus?
Because you get a cosine and a sine of 4 pi over a x that you integrate from 0 to a. And this function is periodic and it's full, when it's finished its full period, its average value is 0 on the unit cell. Okay? It's a cosine and sine having the periodicity or multiple. It's periodic over the cell from 0 to 1, and it's a cosine or a sine. So it's 0, its average value. So now the eigenvalue of a matrix of the type. The eigenvalues of a matrix of the type A, B, B, A is just A plus or minus the norm of B. So the eigenvalues of this matrix so this means the correction to the first order in V are plus or minus V1 over 2. Okay? So this is what is the correction for this case here, where we will have a splitting of the degeneracy. So starting from this eigenvalue, we will have one eigenvalue that will be plus V over V1 over 2, and the other one minus V1 over 2. So one will have a splitting of magnitude V1. This, so this correction here will give us a splitting, and we will have a value here that will be plus V1 over 2 and the other one minus V1 over 2. So we will have a splitting of amplitude V1 here. So in those cases, the first order perturbation theory will split the states at the mean zone edge. So the same will happen here also. One can do the same argument, use the same argument when one considers the states. One here, and it's exactly the same thing. So at the Brillouin zone edge, one will have a splitting. So I would like now to discuss a little bit this and also the validity of the perturbation theory, when and why one expects it to be valid. And one has to consider two things. So for the degenerate, there is something, of course, that must happen by continuity from this case to this case, because here the band split, so one must have by continuity also some effect here. The point is, by first order perturbation theory, there is no correction here, but we can expect that close to this edge, even if these states are non-degenerate, there will be an important second order correction. And the reason is that if one uses goes to perturbation theory to the second order for non-degenerate state. So for non-degenerate states, the second order correction in the perturbation V is my second order correction for the value eigenvalue I, where I have a non-degenerate state I. From quantum mechanics, one knows that it's a sum over J eigenstate J different from I, from the eigenstate I. So one has to sum over all the other eigenstates. The matrix element J V I modulo square divided by the energy difference between these two eigenstates. So A I 0 minus A I T G 0. So the second order correction, if I have a state here, which is non-degenerate, is obtained by considering the other eigenstate and calculating the matrix element of the perturbation and divided by the energy difference. But of course, when I approach a degeneracy at the edge of the Brillouin zone, these two states here are very close in energy. So the denominator is extremely small and one will have a very, very large contribution. So actually, near the Brillouin zone edge, where one has a degeneracy at the edge, one can expect that second order perturbation correction will give an important contribution. And that's why one has the second order correction will essentially give because the bands have to be continuous. So actually they will be important here and they will make the continuation to the edge result. Instead, when one goes further away, like here, the energy difference is very large, so the second order correction will be much smaller, and will be very small, and the state will essentially remain like in the free electrons case. So, just to summarize, so the separation A J 0 minus A I 0 must for this correction to be small, this separation must be much larger than the perturbation matrix. Then the perturbation matrix element. Magnitude of the perturbation of the matrix element and close to plus or minus pi over A. The first order is not enough. Okay. Now, this is one of the features. The other feature I wanted to mention is, of course, for the perturbation theory, for the first order approach to be correct here and give an accurate result, one has to have also that the V is small, and in mathematically the metric element of or the amplitude of V should be small compared to the typical bandwidth. So I wanted to give you also the bandwidth. So for first order perturbation theory to work, the typical expectation values matrix J V I, which are of the order of the coefficient V1, they must be much smaller than the typical bandwidths or typical unperturbed eigenvalues. Which I can estimate. So this bandwidth, it's easy to evaluate, so it's h bar over 2m times pi over a square, and this I can rewrite it as h bar square over 2m a0 square, using as a0 the Bohr radius, times pi over something which has no dimension, that is a over a zero and square. And so a zero is the Bohr radius. And it's equal approximately to this, 5.2 something Einström. So this is the Bohr radius, and this h bar square over 2m a0 square is the Rydberg. So this is the Rydberg, and it's equal to 13.6 eV. So this is this coefficient is about 13, yeah. And this actually a over a is typically of the order of, I mean, typically 3-4 angstrom for metal, I mean, of that type. So here one has essentially 1/2 or something of that type. So squared it's 1/4. So typically this part is of the order for real metals, simple metal, of the order of 0.1 eV to 1 eV this part. considering the A of a typical metal, and therefore the whole thing here is of the order of 1 to 10 eV. So this is what I also told you before, typical bandwidth are the order of the 7 eV, usually. So this is of the order one to 10 eV. So this is the typical bandwidth. So this is large with respect to the typical perturbation that are in metal, corresponding to the oscillation of the midfield potential. Okay, so this is what I wanted to tell you, and I want to give you one exercise for next time, a homework. That is, I would like you to evaluate the splitting here. So do the same thing here. And so the homework is for the quasi-free electron model to examine the splitting or what happens for the degeneracy at k equal to zero there. So homework. So it's on the quasi electron model in one dimension. So quasi-free electron model, so in the one-dimensional case, I want you to evaluate similarly the splitting at the Brillouin zone center, so one calls this point gamma, so this is k equal to zero, one calls it the gamma point, gamma. For the degenerate state. So, n equal to plus or minus 1. So for these two degenerate state, to examine the splitting at the Brillouin center, and to discuss the condition for splitting. Evaluate the splitting in the same way we did it at the Brillouin zone edge, analogously to that, and then to discuss the condition you will see when one can lift the degeneracy, in which conditions. For which potential one can lift the legends. Okay, so that's it. And I will stop here. Do you have any questions? No.